difference, one cup at a time.
Tea time.
Yeah, this is tea time.
Yeah.
Making a difference, one cup at a time.
Tea time.
So be sure to grab your tea, grab a seat, and tune in to Miss Liz.
Tea time. Making a difference, one cup at a time.
Good morning, good morning. We are here and it is morning tea time. Today we are doing three shows. That's right, 2023. Three shows, three live different guests that will be coming in. And this morning we're joined with Danny Covey from Embrum, Ontario, Canada. That's right, we're doing Canada first. And then we're jumping into Kenya, then the United States. We're all over today. So we're going to be serving some strong, strong tea. But before we get started, let's do the disclaimer and all that good stuff. And then a little intro to who Danny is. And then we're going to sit back and serve a good, strong TEA to you all this morning on Tea Time with Miss Liz. So the disclaimer for Miss Liz's Tea Time live shows. Miss Liz, myself, is going live using StreamYard. Before leaving a comment, please grant StreamYard permission to see your name at StreamYard.com. Please be advised that the content brought forward for any Tea Times hosted by myself, Miss Liz, is always brought forward in good faith, however, may bring forth dialogue and opinions that are not representative of my platform. The facts and information are perceived to be accurate at the given time of airing. All Tea Time guests and audience participation are responsible for using their good judgment in taking any action that may relate to the discussion. The content brought forward may include discussions for some where they may be emotionally at risk. It is significant to know that this show is engaging in discussion forms only to offer and inspire awareness and connection and is not providing therapeutical advice. If you have any questions about the disclaimer or the panelist discussion, you may freely contact me, Miss Liz, through my email at bookingmissliz@gmail.com. Moving forward, should you choose to voluntarily participate in today's show in any aspect, I, Miss Liz, welcomes you. Should you decide that this show is not made for you at this time, I respect that, and I will see you at a later show at a later date and time. Now we got that out of the way. Let's get some little intro here into our incredible guest who is joining me today. Danny Covey lives in Embrum, Ontario, Canada, with his beautiful wife, Carly, and their three children, Grant, Layla, and Carter. Danny is a creative Renaissance man who works as a graphic designer, illustrator, marketer, art instructor, and an amateur video producer. Danny's parents joked that he was born with a pencil in his hand, and from a young age he was drawing and entertaining anyone who would pay attention. Despite having a good sense of humor, things haven't always been easy. Danny has faced many trials throughout his life. Beginning at 18 months old, he underwent four open heart surgeries and four invasive heart related procedures, which have left pronounced physical and psychological scars tissue on his body and his mind. He nearly died on the operating table three times and was repeatedly told that he would never be able to excel physically. Yet after much grit and prayer, Danny earned a black belt in jiu-jitsu and continues training today. His great accomplishments came on the heels of having his ruptured descending arterial arch replaced in 2017. I hope I'm saying that right. I'll get him to say it when he comes in. So Danny is a story. He is a miracle. And today I want to share his story with all of you listeners out there and viewers who are watching the live video. So let's get Danny in there and let me grab a sip of tea because my throat is getting a little scratchy. Welcome, Danny.
Welcome. Thank you so much for having me on. I'm very happy to be here.
It is an honor to have you here. I'm just going to grab a cup of tea. So if you'd like to share with the audience a little bit about you, Danny, that I haven't said in the bio, and then we're going to get into some good strong tea here.
Sure, that would be great. You did a great introduction. My name is Danny Covey. I'm a marketer, graphic designer, video producer. I'm the husband to a smoking hot wife named Carly, the father of three amazing kids, and the survivor of 8 heart surgeries. And I think what sums up a lot of what I've gone through really well is a quote that I came across by Richard Paul Evans. And that says, usually life's greatest gifts come wrapped in adversity. And that has been true for me, but it's been many years of challenge, but also many years of incredible blessing.
Well, thank you so much, Danny, for sharing that. And I did notice when I did some research, because that's what I do is I research all my guests here. and I got a frog in my throat. I don't know what's going on here, but might be nerves, might be anxiety, all that good stuff, right? So I did notice that there is a possible chance of a 9th surgery, right, to be discussed in the future?
It's always possible. When I was 13, I had a mechanical valve put in my heart. And at the time, the longest they'd had one last was about 12 years. I've had mine for about 31 years now, actually almost 33 years. And so every year I ask my cardiologist, how much longer is it going to last? And he says, well, they can last indefinitely, but there's always a possibility it'll need to be replaced someday. And I don't consider myself to be that old. So I'm always thinking in the back of my mind, maybe one day, but we'll see. Time will tell.
So, Danny, if you'd like to share a little bit of, with the listeners and the viewers out there, what procedures you had done and what ages? I have the ages and years all here, but I'd like to come from you.
Sure. So I think really to tell my story, well, I have to begin with my parents. Some of my surgeries are before I even remember them. So my parents grew up in Saskatchewan, Regina, Saskatchewan. I am the third of 4 children. And so, you know, when I was a baby, my mom noticed one day I was eating an orange, and then she heard me crying, and then the crying stopped. She looked at me and I was choking. And so she thought maybe I'd been choking on an orange peel. And so at the time I was about a year old, almost a year old, actually around a year old. And so she had the doctor check me out and they said, well, nothing seems to be wrong. Everything seems okay. And then this happened again and again and again, where I would pass out. I'd literally turn gray. They'd rush me to the hospital. They'd give me oxygen. I would be revived. And the doctors didn't have an explanation. So I give my parents credit for this. They went to 11 different doctors. And it was that 11th doctor that listened to my heart and he said, he's got a trill in his heart and he needs to be rushed to Sick Kids Hospital in Toronto, Ontario. So for me, my first open heart surgery was when I was about 18 months old. I'd had a small surgical procedure before that just to see what was going on with my heart. And then a few weeks later, that's when I went to Toronto at about 18 months. So I grew up seeing scars on my wrists, my chest, and I didn't know how they got there. I just was told the stories, but I had no memory of how they actually got there myself. So that's really when it started, really for my parents. And then I grew up hearing the stories and life was relatively normal, if I can say that, till I was about 8 years old.
And when you were 8, I believe that was when you had your third surgery, right?
Yes. So at 8 years old, kind of just as a diagnostic, my cardiologist said, look, your health seems good. We'd like to do what's called a heart catheterization. And that's It's not an incredibly invasive procedure, but it is a heart procedure where they make an incision in your groin, in your leg. They stick a tube up to your heart. They take different readings and measurements, and then they remove it and you're stitched up. And so they did that when I was 8, just to kind of see, well, how is his heart? We haven't really taken a really close look. And I remember it being in the hospital, and when the doctors entered the room, the look on their faces told my parents not everything was good. And the real challenge for me is, when I was born, I had problems with my aortic valve and my mitral valve. The surgery that I had as a baby, at 18 months, corrected my mitral valve for the most part. My aortic valve would always narrow. It would get too small. And so the surgeries, they would try and make incisions to open them up. They'd add patches around the heart. And so that's what they did. In the fall of 1985, when I was 8, I had which would be my third heart surgery, but my second open heart surgery.
Wow.
And so that was pretty invasive. That's the first surgery that I really remember. And it, especially for somebody that young, it was quite an ordeal. And I would say, there's a mental health aspect to this too, where as a young kid, just not knowing what is this going to be like, not knowing what to expect, and then going through it. And thankfully I was in the hospital for about 3 weeks. My aortic valves seemed to be doing well. There were no complications. It was a long but good recovery. And so that was right after that. That was when life kind of went back to normal for a few short years.
Yeah, because you had quite a few surgeries after that that I found. Like in 88, you had 2 surgeries, actually. You had your fifth one, right?
I had about, in the 80s, I had about 5 surgeries in 5 years.
Wow.
So after that heart surgery in 85, my health was good, but there were still problems. And what I would experience, there'd be tightness in my chest, difficulty breathing. Before 2 of my surgeries, I went into congestive heart failure. So I had rapid weight gain. I had a lot of fluid retention around my body. I was fainting. I was kind of that kid that I had to carry an oxygen tank around with me. So other parents of my friends were nervous about having me over for sleepovers in case something happened. But at the time, this seemed normal to me. Like, this was just life. And I didn't really understand just how abnormal that was, I guess. So when I was 8, I had the second open heart surgery. It did okay, but that valve kept kind of trying to restrict. So when I was about 12, they did what was called an aortic angioplasty, or a ballooning procedure, I'm sorry, where they stuck a tube in my heart and they tried to expand the valve.
Oh, so it's like a balloon.
A ballooning. And that bought me about a year. They were hoping that would have more of a long-term effect. It didn't. And so that bought me about a year. In 1989, in the summer of 1989, I had another heart catheterization, again, to see where things were at. And the results from that surgery indicated like I was going into severe congestive heart failure. And so I was about 13. I actually went into the hospital the day after my 13th birthday.
Wow.
And so my I had some friends over, and then the next day we drove to Toronto. I checked in, and this was for me the big surgery, because every heart operation before this, the goal was to expand my valve, try and make it bigger. And the thinking on this one was we would just remove the valve entirely and put in an artificial valve. And so that's what they did. My aortic valve was removed. There was patches put in my heart again. And then a mechanical valve. It's called a St. Jude mechanical valve. And I thought this was interesting. It's called the St. Jude valve because St. Jude was the patron saint of lost causes.
Oh.
So the valve was put in, and this surgery was extremely serious. I nearly died because I just had excessive bleeding that would not stop. They had sewn me up. The bleeding continued, and they thought, we're going to have to reopen them up again and try and get this bleeding to stop. So after some complications, I survived, spoiler alert, and began to heal. And where this surgery was a bit different, I don't know if your listeners or viewers can hear it, but my valve actually ticks like a clock.
Yeah, that's what you were telling me. It was like a watch clock.
Yeah, so I have a lot of people say, like, oh, you're wearing a watch. I can hear your watch. I said, I'm not wearing a watch. Like, it's just, mm-hmm. It's my heart. And so if I'm running, it's, if I'm slow and I'm, you know, calm and relaxed, it's much slower, but it's very audible. And it's kind of a reminder to me that, you know, I hear that, and it's just a reminder, like, it's a gift. Every day is a gift. And that's how I try to view it. Despite all the challenges that I've had in the past, like, none of us are guaranteed, you know, 100 years, 80 years, 50 years. So what the time that we do have, it is a gift for us to use.
Well, and that's why I called you a miracle heart, because you got such a big heart, right? And like your heart has gone through so much. And I'm glad that you brought up mental health, Danny, because we need to understand that all these surgeries does affect the mental health. It affects the mindset and all that, because growing up, you had a different life than an average child, you know, like you said, like you're a deoxygen machine. So what effects did it have on your mental health?
I'm actually really glad you brought that up, because over the past 2 years, I've been writing a book about my journey and my story. And it's interesting looking back on what I went through as a child through the lens of an adult. And there's a lot of things that I just took as normal as a child that I look back and say, that's not normal at all. And so when I was 8, I had hair back then, but I started losing my hair. And my doctor said, well, it's probably stress related. And I said, why would I lose my hair? I'm not stressed. But I realized my body was going through a tremendous amount of stress. What I've really noticed since then, we can talk about my other surgery. I had surgery about 5 years ago. My aorta had ruptured, and I shouldn't even be here after that happened. People generally don't come back from having an aorta rupture and they live to talk about it. But my aorta had ruptured. I was without blood or oxygen for about 9 minutes. And so when I came to, I didn't know any of this. I was heavily medicated. Once I started going off the medication a few months later, and that's when I noticed some inconsistencies. I noticed some interesting things that I never really noticed before. For instance, I would get lost driving to work, or I'd get lost in my own neighborhood, or I felt like my brain was in a constant fog. I'd also experience, I found loud noises, or like my family and I went to a soccer game and I had to leave because it was just so much activity. And so it's like, my senses got overloaded very easily. And at first I thought it was all in my head and I didn't understand what was going on. There was a few weeks I thought I was just going crazy. I said, what is wrong with me? I'm losing things. I can't remember things. I'd ask my wife something and she'd look at me. She says, you've asked me this 3 times already. And so I didn't understand what was going on. And so I did some, you know, asking around. I did some research, and there's a condition called post-operative cognitive disorder that a lot of people, if they've experienced or they've been put under an anesthetic or they go through a severe trauma or surgery, there is some cognitive challenges. So I ended up going to a neurologist, and my visit with him was interesting. He did an MRI on my head, and he said, you've had what we call anoxic brain trauma from lack of oxygen. And the where mental health comes into this, I found it's had quite a profound impact on my personality. I still like joking. But I used
to did that in the background. He was doing that before we started this live show. And I'm like, but he has a good sense of humor. So that's a good thing, Danny.
Yeah, I loved being the center of attention. I love joking. Now, I didn't understand it, but now I'm just happy to be a wallflower. I still like joking, but I don't like being that center. I don't mind creating a center of attention. But I found the effects of that brain trauma, it has affected my personality. It affects how I perceive things. Some days it's just like I feel like there's hands on the back of my head and I just cannot think. It's like a fog. And then other days it's crystal clear. And so I've looked at what I can do to help. This exercise is a huge help. Getting enough sleep is a huge help. Eating a good diet is a huge help, but it's still there and it still has its effects. So that's something that I've had to kind of walk through, and it's been challenging for my wife. She says, at one point she says, I miss my old husband. And so it's been an adjustment for us as a family, but I do have an incredible family. They've been a great support, but it's helped me empathize with people that do have mental health challenges of their own, and they go through difficult things on their own, because I understand it now. I understand how getting out of bed some days is a great achievement.
Yeah.
Or there's other days where you can take on the world and you feel like you can do that. I don't understand why it's one day like this and the next day it's not, but I've just learned, go through it. And the challenge for me, even not surgeries, but just mental health wise, if I refuse to do things, then I feel like I'm building a wall up around myself. So for instance, if I don't enjoy being around crowds and I say, I'm going to avoid crowds, then I become the guy who can't be around crowds. If I say, I'm going to willingly choose to go where crowds are and tolerate a certain amount and then back off, then it becomes something that I learn to manage. And I'm not that guy.
So Danny, because of what has happened, is that why they were considering to do the ninth heart surgery?
The ninth heart surgery, as of right now, is not on the table. Okay. My health is good.
That's good.
Everything is working as it should. It's just a possibility that down the road, the mechanical valve that I have now may run into problems. My mitral valve may run into problems. I wouldn't say the door is slammed shut, but it's closed. It's always possible that it may be down the road, but as I understand it now, we're good for today.
Well, that's good. Well, like I said, you're a living miracle, right? Like eight surgeries, and you're here sitting here and having tea with us today. So let's get into your tea, Danny. So if I ask you, what is your tea? What kind of tea are you serving today to the audience?
I would say, I don't know how much sense these would make, but for me, the tea in tea is trial. I've been through so many different trials with each of my surgeries as a child and then again as an adult. And those trials, I don't believe they're not without purpose. And something that really helped me along the way as I went through this was a quote that I came across. And when I read this quote, I started to cry, because it kind of solidified, this is why we go through things. And I may butcher it a bit, but I'm going to try and say it the best I can. The quote is this: one day you will tell your story of how you've overcome what you're going through now, and it will become part of somebody else's survival guide. Meaning the things that I face, if I can get through them and I can overcome them, then I help somebody else who's suffering. There's people that I turn to when I was suffering, that I was having challenges with, and they were a tremendous help to me. So in a roundabout way, that's the trial. I would say the second letter would be endurance. Ooh, it's just I've faced so many of these surgeries at different ages. I've been, like you had mentioned, I've nearly died three times. And there's not a lot of control that we have over things. The only thing we can really control is our attitude when we go through them. And so I can't control what happens to me, but I can control, okay, am I going to let this tear me down? Am I going to become bitter? Am I going to view myself as a victim? Or am I going to choose to endure it, grow from it, get through it? Why? Because somebody needs me. Somebody will need to know what I've been through. And that's really been a driving force in why I'm writing a book and why I'm hoping that will come out this summer. The last letter may seem like an odd one, but agency. And I say agency because so much of what I've been through has been things that have been done to me. I was put to sleep. I was operated on. I joke, I never knew my gym teacher. I never participated in gym class ever. I've never been physically involved in sports. And so agency for me is taking charge of the things that I do have control over and making that mine. So I'm not a passive victim. No, yes, I may have had all these horrible things happen to me, but I'm going to take charge and I'm going to act of my own accord. And that put me at odds with some of my cardiologists. They were not happy when I said, I'd like to get into martial arts. And they said, you absolutely cannot. You've had 8 surgeries. Your health, your heart is poor. I said, what if I was smart about it? And for me, that was just taking charge of the things that I can control and doing something. So those are my trials, endurance, and agency.
And there you go. See, we have a nice strong cup of tea this morning on Tea Time. And this is what it is. Every tea is different. Everybody has a different tea story. And your story is incredible, Danny. You know, I'm just going to bring up the little video that we have of Danny. And then we're going to give a special thank out to who gave me this incredible guest. And then we'll come right back. So let's just sit back, grab some tea, warm up, fill up your cup again, and we'll be right back. Danny, hold on, don't leave. I'm just going to put this in here and we're going to get some story into a little bit more into Danny's story.
As I walk this great unknown, questions come and questions go. Was there purpose for the pain? Did I cry these tears in vain? I don't want to live in fear. I want to trust that you are near. Trust your grace can be seen in both triumph and tragedy. I have been so in the depth of my soul, in the flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go. But sometimes my faith feels thin, like the night will never end. Will you catch every tear, or will you just leave me here? I have this hope in the depth of my soul. In the flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go. Yes, I have this hope in the depth of my soul. In the flood or the fire, with me and you won't let go. So whatever what happens, I will not be afraid. Cause you are closer than this breath that I take. Yeah, you call the storm when I hear you call my name. Oh, I still believe that one day I'll see your face. I have this hope in the depth of my soul. In the flood or the fire, you are with me. I have this hope in the depth of my soul. In the flood or the fire, you're with me and you won't let go. In the flood or the fire, you are with me and you won't let go. In the flood or the fire, you are with me, you won't let go.
And there you have it. The reason that I wanted to play the video was because you started talking about the jitsu, so I knew that there was a picture in that video with the jitsu, so I wanted to really get into that in the second half of the show. I want to give a special shout out to podcast guests for giving me this incredible guest today on Teatime. Check them out. They have some incredible guests. If you're looking for guests to be featured on your podcast, check out podcast guests. So thank you, podcast guests, for giving me Danny Covey today. And thank you, Danny, for your submission for Teatime. But now let's get into the second half of this incredible story of Danny. Let's get into the good stuff. Again, thank you, Danny, for being here. You are a miracle, and your story is really, truly inspiring. So again, thank you for coming and sharing your tea. And your tea is strong. Keep that tea going. But let's get into the good stuff. Let's get into the jitsu. Like they told you, you couldn't do it, and you got your black belt. So for all the listeners out there that don't know about jitsu, could you share a little bit about that?
Sure. There's jiu-jitsu, there's different types. There's what's called Japanese jiu-jitsu, and a lot of people are more familiar with Brazilian jiu-jitsu, where it's grappling on the ground. But what started that journey for me, and this is where agency comes into it, as 8-year-old kid, 9-year-old kid, never being allowed to do gym class, never being involved in anything, I'd sit and I'd watch Jackie Chan, I'd watch Bruce Lee, I'd watch some of the things that they would do, and I was spellbound, absolutely spellbound. The idea of training in martial arts was an utter impossibility for me. It wouldn't get past several gatekeepers, being my parents, my doctors, my cardiologists. But I remember that journey for me began around 10 years old, when I saw a karate book at Kohl's bookstore, and I begged my dad, can I please buy this book? And so he agreed. And my evenings then consisted of me holding this book in one hand and practicing punches and kicks in front of the mirror in my bedroom. That's really how my journey began. And so after my aortic surgery when I was 13 and I had my valve put in, my health actually drastically improved. And so I'm not even sure how I managed to do this, but I convinced my parents, could I please try karate? I will never compete. No one will touch me. No one will beat up on me, but I just like to practice. And I managed to convince my cardiologists on the condition that I not compete in tournaments. And so for me at, I think I was about 14 when I first started karate, it was like a dream come true. So I could never spar, I could never compete, but I could practice the moves, I could be training with everybody else. And that was a dream come true.
Well, it was almost like being part of society as well, right? Being able to do something like everybody else was doing.
Oh yeah. And it was, for me, that was, I can't explain it other than to say it felt like a counterbalance to everything that had happened to me. And now I was taking charge and pulling things in another direction. And so I did that for a number of years. And then, unfortunately, life happened. I graduated high school. I went to college. I got married. I had kids. And so that dream, that goal kind of got crowded out over time. And in my mid-30s, I started to feel it again. Hey, you've always wanted to get a black belt. When are you going to do that? If you don't do it now, when are you going to do it? And so probably not the smartest move, but I thought, I want to earn this. I don't want special treatment. So I started jiu-jitsu in Ottawa, and I did not tell my instructors anything about my past. I didn't tell them I had surgery. I thought in my head, I want to be treated like everyone else. And that worked for close to a year until one day I was testing for one of my belts. You advance different belt levels. And I couldn't catch my breath. I was bent over and my instructor said, come on, get back in here. And I said, just a minute, I've had heart surgery. And he says, get back. He says, what? You've had what? And so it kind of came out, and I was chastised for not letting them know earlier. But once I did know, my attitude was always, look, I don't want to be treated differently. Yeah. And so I got to a brown belt level, which is just before black. And that was around my 40th birthday. And that was when I ran into problems with my aortic valve. And so I had my surgery. My valve had ruptured. They repaired it. And I was recovering. But that dream, even though I was so close, seemed years away. And you saw in the video that you showed earlier, there's pictures of me with a lot of different people. After I had heart surgery, I started walking. And I walked every day, and sometimes up to 2 hours a day. And I'd love to bring people with me. If I can have meetings, we're doing meetings while we're walking. If we're catching up, it's walking. And so there was a walk one night where my chest hurt. I was slumped over. It was raining. And I was stubborn. I thought, I'm not stopping. I need to get my time in. And it's raining. And I was dreaming about getting back into martial arts. And it just seemed so ridiculous. I couldn't even stand barely. And I was shuffling along. And I just thought, no, I got to get back into it. I got to get back into it. And so now when I was at the Heart Institute, as a child, I had my surgeries at Sick Kids Hospital. As an adult, I had it at the Heart Institute in Ottawa. And I was telling my cardiologist, I said, I'd like to get back into jiu-jitsu. He says, absolutely not, out of the question. He says, you've had too much done. And I said, but I'm going to do it. I'm not going to be stupid about it. I'm going to be smart. I'm going to be wise. I'm not going to push past what my limits are. He says, no, you can't. And I said, what are you thinking of when I say jiu-jitsu? And he was thinking the cage matches with UFC where they're breaking arms. So I literally showed him on YouTube. We pulled up clips on YouTube in his office. And I said, this is what I want to do. There's mats. It's safe. It's not excessive force. And so he very, 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 very reluctantly said, okay, but be careful. That was the same message I got from my parents, my family. Their attitude was, you've come this far, it's good enough.
Yeah.
And I've always said, look, if I'm driving somewhere and I get halfway and I say, look how far I came, and then I turn around and go back, what's the point? And so in December 2018, exactly 20 months after my last open heart surgery, I did a 5-hour test. I gave it everything I had, and I survived, and I earned a black belt in Japanese jiu-jitsu.
Well, congratulations. I am so proud of you. Like, it is amazing what your mind can put you through, you know? Like, you went through so much surgeries, Danny, but you were determined to get this black belt. And that just shows you, when we keep pushing through our challenges and our struggles in life, that we can actually make something of ourselves. when we don't stay in it, right? When we say, you know what, there's more for me out there. Now, you talk about walking, and I've done some searching, and you have put out a call out to Rachel McAdams to walk with you. So why Rachel McAdams, and also the Bring Awareness to the Heart Society and all that? That's also next month, I believe, in February is Heart Month. So if you want to share a little bit about that with the audience.
So my marketer brain is always working. My wife and I are huge fans of Rachel McAdams and her films. And she just so happens to be Canadian. She seems very likable. She's a great actress. And I know she has lived in Canada or has family here. So it was always, would it ever happen? Could I make this happen? And so because I walk a lot, I have lots of different people walk with me. Some people I see once a year, we go for a 2-hour walk and we catch up, and then I see them the next year. But I thought, how cool would it be? How amazing if myself and my wife were able to actually walk with Rachel McAdams. And what I would love to do, and I'm still putting the call out there, is use that time that we're walking to promote Sick Kids Hospital in Toronto, which is where I've had most of my surgeries. It's a hospital that has doctors that have saved my life several times. And I would also like to use this as an opportunity to promote the Heart Institute. So I put a short little video together to show Rachel that I'm not some crazy stalker. I'm a competent man of sound mind who appreciates what she does. And I would love just to converse. And so the interesting thing is, I put out a video a few years ago. And my understanding, and Rachel, if you're watching, correct me if I'm wrong, my understanding was the video did make it to her publicist.
Well, that's a start.
That's a start. And then from there, COVID happened. You know, things have been drastically changed. So I'm not hoping, I'm believing, and I'm expecting that somehow it's going to get to her. And somehow she'll see, hey, this is a good cause. This will do good, and it'll give us a chance to kind of have a walking tea time, if you will, with a great actress.
She is an incredible actress. So Rachel McAdams, if you are listening, or if you do get this tea time out there to your publicist, we're putting a second call out for you to walk with Danny, and that is in February. So we still have time, Danny. We could pull this off if we, you know. So again, share this tea time for all the viewers and listeners out there. Share this tea time. Let's get it out there and let's make this man's dream come true. Because Danny, you are a true amazing man. And like I said, we're so close. We're only an hour apart. So let's get together and let's actually have a face-to-face tea time, you know. And
I would love that.
And I would love to walk with you, Danny. And, you know, so anything that you're doing in February for the Heart Society and the hospitals as well, let me know and I'll put some special shout outs on Mrs. Tea Times and that for you as well.
Okay.
Now we do have a couple viewers and listeners that are tuning in, and we do have some questions that are coming in, and I want to get to those questions. So we have a question here. What has your heart surgery taught you about yourself?
Okay. Oh, that's a loaded question. I'll say a couple things. What's gotten me through difficult seasons of life has been my faith. And sometimes that faith looks stubborn. It's just a stubbornness. It's a refusal to accept what you're told and to plow ahead anyway. And so really, for me, I've looked at my surgeries as opportunities to help others. And I know that sounds incredibly cliche. My last surgery, my wife and I discussed, should we keep this private? Should we, you know, just not tell people? And I thought, no, people are going to find out. But I think we should share exactly what we're going through, because other people are going to go through surgery. I had a teenager in Newfoundland reach out to me about 3 years ago. He was having heart problems. And he says, thank you for what you've posted. It's helped me. And I've called him many times. We've had great conversations. I've answered a lot of his questions. So again, it comes back to that quote that I gave you earlier. we go through hard things because that becomes someone else's survival guide. And for me, I had another heart surgery, and as strange as that sounds, that was something I was familiar with. I've been through it before. It's not something radically different that I didn't know how to handle. I didn't know the cues that I would be going through. So what's got me through it, it's just knowing that there's a purpose for them and knowing that my purpose here is to help others. I've really, really, really tried to stay away from asking the why me question. Why did this happen to me? Because you'll never get a good answer. You'll never get a satisfactory answer. What I've tried to do instead, and I absolutely mean this, what is this teaching me? The why question? No. The what question? Now I can do something.
Well, and that's what our stories do, right, Danny, is they teach us, right? And that's what Tea Time is all about, teaching educational awareness. When you hear teaching educational awareness, we're not giving you a book. We're not giving you a course. We're not giving programs. We're giving life stories of teaching that the awareness of knowing different stories actually do heal. And it's like that quote that you said, you know, and I'm going to get you to send me that quote so I can put that up with a write-up after your Tea Time. And you can see in the back of Miss Liz here, for the ones that are watching the video, sharing is healing. You know, if we don't share, we don't heal. We need other people to hear our story so that we can heal as well, because we can't heal alone. Healing is a journey with a community, not just ourselves. The healing is within ourselves, but we need that community to actually say, you know what, you got this. You know, we need that support. So we have another question here, Danny.
Okay.
For anyone who is going through open heart surgery, what message would you have for them?
You have to fight for your health. I think well-intentioned family members and doctors and people are going to say, you're going to have heart surgery, your life is going to look like this. And again, that can come from really places of good intention, but some of that is just limits. And I don't know the specific situation that other people go through, but I just know for me, if my parents hadn't gone to 11 doctors, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you today. So if it's your health and you're facing something and it's discouraging, fight for it. If your doctors tell you to do something, you know, follow this regime, it'll help you get better, do it. Fight to do it. For me, I was told in my last surgery, oh, you have to stay on these medications for the rest of your life. And I said, I don't want to stay on those. And so I fought to get off of them because I didn't want to be on unnecessary medication. They said you couldn't do jiu-jitsu. I fought to do it. I've been wise about it. But, and I'm not advocating just do your own thing and not listen to advice. That's not what I'm saying. But I am saying that now, because I've been walking, because I've been active physically, it's actually made my heart stronger than if I hadn't done those things. So in anything, to answer that question, fight for your health.
Well, I like that you say that, Danny, because we have to be the advocate, right? We have to be that one that says, you know what, okay, this doctor says this, let's ask another doctor and let's see, you know, let's get a second opinion, a third opinion. You know, and I'm glad that your parents have reached out to 11 doctors and that you're sitting here today and having tea with me. So I want to thank your parents for doing that and reaching out and being that advocate for you as well, because we need that as well as, you know, parents advocating for our kids, you know. So let's get into a little bit of the other stuff that you do, Danny, before we wrap up your tea time, because time is just flying by so fast this morning. So you're also a graphic designer and an illustrator, art instructor, all of that good stuff. So how does that come into place in your life, Danny?
So I went to school and for illustration, and that's where I met my wife. My wife, she's an artist as well. And I always said I'd never marry an artist, yet here I am. The nice thing is, though, our styles are very different. And so we complement. When she's working on a painting, I can offer critique and it's not threatening me and vice versa. So I did a lot of cartooning, caricaturing in the past. This may surprise you, but the term starving artist does actually come from somewhere. And I found, hey, it's going to be challenging to make a living at this. So I got into more graphic design and I've done that for a number of years. More recently, I've gotten into marketing, and I do video production for various businesses, just kind of promoting what they do. But that's why I say I'm a bit of a Renaissance man. I don't like saying I'm a jack of all trades, master of none. I do a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this. But what I love is that they're all creative. And to me, that's, I love being able to create. I love being able to think of something here, close my eyes, and I see it. And then a week later, a month later, a year later, I can hand it to you. Or I can click it and say, watch this. I just love that creative process of like dreaming something and then manifesting it. I absolutely love that. Whether it's writing, music, design, video, you name it. It's the same thing. It's just different tools, different ways of accomplishing it.
Well, and it gives you a way of expressing yourself as well, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And then for a number of years, I've taught here in Ottawa. And again, I love teaching students and just seeing like that light turn on where they find something that gets them motivated. And I love being able to do that or just stay in touch with students and bouncing ideas off of them and telling them, hey, try this. And then that explodes a whole new world for them. So I love being involved in that. I love keeping my fingers in all pies that are creative, I guess I would say.
So are you more of the artsy crafty kind of art instructor, or are you the digital kind of instructor? Like, do you prefer the digital over the hands-on?
I've done both. I've taught life drawing for a number of years, and that's very hands-on, like physical, you know, pencils and charcoal and paints. I enjoy that. I also enjoy the digital. And the interesting thing with digital art is there's tools that my students are showing me. Oh, did you know you can do this? I'm like, I've taught this for so many years. I didn't know you could do that. So I find I'm constantly learning, but I like the variety of it. I think if it was the same thing every day, that might get boring. But because there's so much variety, because there's so many different ways that art can take expression. For instance, if I'm painting and I'm composing a painting, that's the same process if I'm storyboarding for a video. The principles of art are the same for principles of composition when I'm filming something. And that's the carryover. That's the common thread that I love through all of this, is the same principles apply, and it's exciting to apply them in different areas.
Oh, I like that. And you just taught me something, because I love playing with graphics and stuff and that as well, as you can tell, right? Because I love playing with the alignments and the different forms and angles that we can put, you know, images and colors and all of that. I just love playing with the rainbow. I call it playing with the rainbow. Like, my art is just the rainbow. It's like a cup of tea, right? You just flow it and spill it and just make a good old big mess. But Danny, for the illustration and all of that, is it like cartoon illustration?
So I've done, years ago, I drew for the newspapers. So I would do political cartooning, just plain cartooning. The Ottawa Hospital newsletter, I drew cartoons for their newsletter. So I like the cartoony fun stuff. I like to exaggerate things. You see things a certain way, and then you accentuate them, or you take liberties, I guess I would say.
Oh, I love that. So I want to get into, before we wrap up, because we're almost at the end of our show, I want to get into the Danty rants that I found on your website. Could you tell us a little bit about those?
So Danty rants, again, was an idea of what's something I could have fun with, that I could build a community of people around, that I would find gratifying, that would be uplifting, that's not just bad news. It's something that would draw people's interest. So the idea that I arrived at was, people can write and ask me a question about anything. And do I know everything? Nope. And what I don't know, I'm going to make fun of and do something silly. And that was Danty Rant. So I'd have different people write me questions, and I'd take the questions. I'd find ones that I found interesting, or maybe I didn't know. I'd do a little bit of research. And then I'd prepare a short, funny video, like 3 to 4 minutes, answering those questions. And then I would post it online. And what I absolutely loved about that is how it built community, much like your podcast does. There's a community of people that it builds and they turn to that. And I loved being able to do that, is to build this thing and then just sit back and say, look at all the joy that that's bringing people. And that was the idea behind it, is just, let's make something fun, something light, but also something that people can kind of get behind and find, you know, humor in. It brightens their day. And they're mentioned by name. So if you had written in with a question, I'd say, you know, today's question is from Liz and here's what she has to say. And so that, it was just kind of like each week it was, well, is he going to mention my name? Is my question going to get answered? And there was always that unknown, like you may be involved, you may not be. And that was the fun of it for me.
And you see, Miss Liz does her homework. I study my guests. Like, I don't come to the table and say, spill your tea. I actually check out these guests and I'm like, oh, that's a little interesting, right? So I want to thank you again, Danny, for joining me today on Tea Time. And I want to thank the Mental Health Warriors for tuning in. I want to thank Bathroom Moments. Check them out. You know, I'm going to connect you with two of these incredible men that have joined us. Okay. They have incredible platforms, and I believe that your story would make a difference on their platforms as well. So I want to thank those viewers and tuners and listening in. I want to thank the viewers and listeners that have tuned in on other platforms. And I have seen your questions, and I will pass them along to Danny. So I want to thank you, Danny. But any final words before we wrap up your tea? And any special shout outs that you would like to give to any family members or any of that good stuff before we wrap up?
I just want to thank you for having me on. I had mentioned I'm in the process of having my own book published that I'm hoping to be out this summer. So for those that may be interested, they can check that out. It's been an incredible process writing about that. And I could not have done that without the support of my parents, who have been with me from day one and still support me, even now, my family. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be on your show just to talk about this, talk about mental health, talk about health in general, and just not being overcome by adversity. I think that's huge. And I want to do a little bit of show and tell, if you'll let me. This will take just 1 second.
Oh, yes. Go ahead. It's your time.
Okay. So a common phrase for me is just the idea that you never give up. And my niece taught me how to sign that. So I would like to sign it and just remind people, whatever you're going through, don't give up. And it's this. And that just simply means never give up.
Could you do that again, Danny?
Wow. So that's my reminder. Be stubborn about your goals, but flexible about your methods. And if you've got a goal, it may look different in how you get there, but don't give up on it.
I love it. And I love the flow of it. So is that sign language that you just taught us?
It is sign language. I can thank my niece Kirsten for showing that to me. So it's my one party trick now. So
I'll have to connect you with one of the other tea times that I had on here with the American Sign Language. She writes children's books, and I think that you guys would really align well together as well. Yeah, and that's what Miss Liz does, is I just connect you guys, and I let you all grow and collaborate and connect and network together. And whatever comes out of it, it comes out a beautiful cup of tea, and that's what we do, is we serve tea here on Tea Time with Miss Liz. And Danny, thank you again for being that miracle man and giving the inspiration this morning. So make sure to never give up on your dreams. And if you want to do it, do it. You know, find a way. There's always a way. So we can always push through our challenges and struggles like Danny has this morning. And Danny is walking, living proof that it can be done when you work and you find the right resources and do it in the right, healthy way. So let's remember that health is always important. And don't forget that February is heart month. So let's keep bringing the awareness to that as well. And again, Danny, thank you so much. And I will see everybody at 3 p.m. with a second tea time today, when I bring in UPANDA, United Foundations, to bring awareness to education and children's empowerment from Kenya. So we'll be jumping into Kenya next. And then we'll be jumping into the United States tonight with Dr. Betty Speaks. where we'll be speaking about changing your life now. So there's a lot of incredible teas coming this way. But Danny, again, thank you so much for joining me today, this morning. And let's stay connected and let's really have a tea face to face. And let's do some walking together and let's see what we can do with that as well. So again, thank you to all the viewers and listeners. And I will see everybody at 3 p.m. for the second tea time. That's right. Every Thursday, there are three shows, three different guests. So be sure to check that out. Danny, thank you so much for joining me this morning. And I will see everybody in a couple of hours for the second tea time.